aspirants, we are back with a new lecture, and today we are going to start a sub-series of philosophy optional subject, that is series on Indian philosophy. This lecture is going to be introduction on Indian philosophy. Here we will try to cover basic overview of Indian philosophy. This lecture is just like an appetizer or warm-up. Here in this lecture, I will broadly touch upon different schools of Indian philosophy and give you some background as how this philosophical thinking has started in India. Also, we will discuss some basic terms used in philosophy. This will make us comfortable to have a good discussion in the next lectures. Also, at the end of this lecture, I will recommend some of the books for Indian philosophy. So, without any further delay, let's start. First of all, let us understand what is this all about. Philosophy in general discuss about these type of questions. The questions like, what is reality? Reality in the sense is that generally in philosophy, it is considered that anything that changes is not real. For example, all material and living things like human body, soil, water, a pen, a table, an iron pillar, or anything for that matter, all the things change with time. They change, they transform, they lose something, they gain something, they expire, they lose their existence, and finally lose their essence. So, philosophy tries to find something from which every other thing in this universe has come out, and something that never loses its essence, and recognize such thing as the ultimate reality. Is there a such thing? Well, we will find answers for this question of different schools and the explanation to this later in this course in detail. The next question is, what is ultimate goal of human life? Here, we are talking like, is human being just an accident, like Mr. Darwin said, in the sense that, is there a God or omnipotent who created this human being and other animals and living beings on some purpose? If so, what is that purpose? Are there any goals that humans should try to achieve? If at all, human being is just an accident, what then should be the ultimate goal of human life? How a human should lead his life? What is that humans should seek so that once he gets it, he won't ask or look for anything else? What is that? Is there such thing? Well, we will see in our course lectures. The next question is, who exactly is God? Or what is God? Who exactly is God? Is there one God or multiple gods? Did God made all this? If so, why evil is there? Why God did not create this world without any chance for pains? Why in God's creation evil exists? Why in God's creation pain exists? Is evil powerful than God? If so, how can we call God as omnipotent? If he is not omnipotent, can he still be God? First of all, does God exist? If so, how you can explain all this? How do you know that he exists? What role he has in the life of human being? Does God really have control on universe and humans in this universe? Is that possible? Does God exist? So, this is also a question we will try to find the answer in this course. Next, we also discussed before, if God is there, what is his role in the life of human being? So, before going further, let me explain a few terms. These terms surfaces very often in philosophical discussions. So, having a good grip on these terms will be helpful for us. The first one is metaphysics. In the word metaphysics, meta means beyond, and physics means, you can say, science. So, metaphysics is the area of study. It studies such things. It studies such ideas which can't be explained by science, which can't be demonstrated practically. And metaphysics try to examine the validity of such ideas or beliefs with the help of logic. So, underline the word logic here. Now, let's go to next term, speculations. Speculation is nothing but a prediction or a statement made by someone without any logical base about the existence of something. Suppose if I say dinosaurs were existing on this planet without any proof or experience, then you can say my statement is just a speculation. But I say so because I found its skeletal remains, that statement I made becomes a rational statement because I made a statement based on some logic. Now, same thing applies to God also. Now, if I say that God exists without any logical base, my statement that God exists will become a speculation because I am talking without any logic. So, any statements that are made without any logical base are called speculations. Let's see another word, dogma. If people start believing these speculations, although they cannot explain this logically or rationally, then these people are called dogmatic. And such ideas that they believe are called dogmas, and the phenomenon, the action that they are believing is called dogmatism. So if you make any statement without a logic, it becomes speculation. If somebody believes this speculation, although they cannot prove it with logic, then they are called dogmatic. And this belief is called dogma, and this phenomenon is called dogmatism. And before believing any statement, or before you subscribe to any idea, if you can follow the logic and test the idea, then you are called a rational man. And such ideas are called as rational ideas. Indian philosophy also tries to give answer for these questions, like, how are we sure of our traditional speculations or beliefs which we derived from the so-called revelations of God? Revelations of God means nothing but the Vedas. Why? Vedas were told to rishis by gods, and rishis have transferred to humans. And even the Upanishads, the Gita, we know the Gita is told by Lord Sri Krishna. We believe that it is revelation of Lord Sri Krishna. But how do you know these statements are true? Philosophy tried to explain this. Are our traditional beliefs are logical? Is our religion nothing but dogma? Now, we already discussed about the word dogma. We will see whether our traditional beliefs are logical or our beliefs are dogma, that is without any logic. We will also discuss about one more question. Is there anything that is permanent regarding human being? If so, how do you explain that? Here we are talking about the popular beliefs called soul and karma, which means that you have to pay for your actions, if not in this life, the next life, and you cannot escape from karma. Indian philosophy tried to explain the truth in these beliefs or concepts. Needless to say, some schools accept these ideas and some reject, but they do so with logic. Now, if you ask me whose logic is correct, I say, let us see in our course lectures. You will find it for yourself. As I talked before, is there one God or multiple gods? Let us see what our ancient scriptures say about this. We will also try to know whether we can prove that God exists and what our ancient thinkers say on this. Now, having slightly understood what we are going to deal with, let's define philosophy. Philosophy literally means love for wisdom. And Jagannath Sinha says it is an attempt to arrive at rational conception of reality as a whole. It is the art of thinking all things logically and systematically and persistently of the reality as a whole. Plato says philosophy is the persistent attempt to see clear notions, that is, continuous effort to know the clear knowledge or concept. It is a rational attempt to have a worldview. Philosophy is not happy with the partial view of the world. Now, science gives sectional view of whole world. For example, mathematical science, it deals with numbers. Physics, it deals with light, heat, motion, sound, etc. Chemistry deals with chemical phenomena. Botany deals with plant life. Geology with animal life. Ethics deals with highest good, virtue, logic, values, etc. And aesthetics deals with beauty and its appreciation. So science gives sectional view of the world. Philosophy tries to synthesize the highest conclusions of different sciences, coordinates them with one another, and give a rational conception of the world. So what philosophy does is, it tries to synthesize the highest conclusions, that is, mathematics says something, physics says something, geology says something, ethics says something. Philosophy tried to gather the conclusions of all these sciences and connect this logically and give us a overall view of the whole world and reality. So this is the job of philosophy. And as per Oxford Learner's Dictionary definition, philosophy is the study of nature and meaning of the universe and of human life. So based on the discussion so far we had, I believe you are convinced of this definition. Moving further, do you ever ask, how do we know? Is there any truth that we can believe? Is a statement true only if it is confirmed by our senses? That is, things that we can touch, taste, smell. Is truth eternal or absolute? Or, as many traditions and religions say, is truth is subject to change? Whatever we confirm by sense observation, is that true? These questions are dealt in another branch of philosophy called epistemology, that is, theory of knowledge. The sources based on which you make a statement and how far those sources are true or valid, we examine such questions in epistemology. In Indian philosophy, Indian philosophical schools, before they answer the metaphysical questions on God or anything, or before they make any metaphysical speculations or statements, they first talk about their epistemology, that is, sources on which their philosophy is built. Now, having proved the validity of their sources, they go further making their philosophical statements and prove those statements with already proven epistemological sources. For example, these are the common epistemological sources. First one is sense experience or perception. This is called as pratyaksha in Sanskrit. Suppose if you strongly say that whatever you see or experience, only that you will believe and nothing other than that, and you make statements purely based on the knowledge from sense experience, and that is with the perception, then your source of knowledge is perception. Now, let us see one famous example in Indian philosophy to understand it much better. That is example of smoke, hill and fire. This is one of the classical example in Indian philosophy, which you will deal many times while we study different Indian philosophical schools. Let us say you are seen from far a smoke on a hill. Then somebody asks you, why there is a smoke on a hill? You may say with your previous experience that smoke is seen only when there is a fire. So you say to that person that there is a fire on a hill, so there is a smoke coming from that hill. Here, when you say there is a fire on the hill, actually you have not seen the fire, but you have made an inference from your previous experience that when there is a smoke, there should be a fire. And based on this, you have concluded that there is a fire on the hill. So the statement that there is a fire on the hill is made based on your previous experience, and from that experience, and you made an inference from that experience and told that there is a fire on the hill. So this is an example of inference, and inference is called as anumana in Sanskrit. In epistemology, we will study the conditions of validity of such sources of knowledge. Because when we make a statement based on some source of knowledge, and if that knowledge itself can be a faulty, then there are chances that the statements you are making may be wrong. The next one is testimony. The Sanskrit word for this is shabda. Let us say you are a child and you believe whatever your father says. And one day he described you about the cow. He told that cow is taller than donkey and it is also taller than a dog. And he said that it is mostly white and it will have some black marks on its skin. And cow has four legs, it has a head and it eats grass. After this, one day you went to forest with your friends. And you have seen one animal as described by your father eating grass, and immediately you told with your friend that, hey, see, this is a cow. Then your friend told you that, no, this is not a cow, this is a horse. Here, when you made a statement that this is a cow, actually you did not have any previous experience or perception of cow. You never saw the cow how it is, but based on the verbal testimony, based on the verbal knowledge that you received from your father, you made a statement that this animal is a cow, but in fact it was a horse. Now, after knowing that it was a horse, now you have a doubt in your mind under what conditions that you can believe the testimony of somebody, or verbal testimony of somebody else, or written testimony of somebody else. Is the conditions in which this testimony can be valid, this we will see in this course. Next one is comparison. The Sanskrit word for this is upamana. This is self-explanatory. You compare two things and then make a statement. We will also see whether this is a valid source of knowledge. Now, before going further, I would like to call your attention onto this. When I say Indian philosophy, or when I say religion or God, I am not just talking about Hindu religion. This is not Hindu philosophy. You can say that it is Hindu philosophy only if you mean that word Hindu in geographical sense, which means that we are talking about philosophy that is born in this country, India. Because if you don't know, there is no religion called Hinduism in the olden days. It was called Sanatana Dharma, which means religion that doesn't have beginning or which is very ancient. We can't find the particular word Hindu in any of the ancient texts. In those days, people used to follow schools. There were Bodhas, and Buddhism was initially all about the way of life. It is a philosophical way of living. Later, after Buddha's death, it slowly became a religion. Then we have Jainas, Vishnuites, Shivites, Vedic followers, Brahmins and others, as we see, who follow different schools of philosophy. There are even people who are atheists, that is, who do not follow any religion. As we will see in our next lecture, they come up with excellent and powerful attack on all religions or concept of religion itself. So here we are not talking about the particular philosophy of Hindu religion, but philosophy of ancient India. And notably, we will see that no school of Indian philosophy talk about particular God. All the schools only talk about the concept of God. And the substitute word for the word God in Indian philosophy is Brahman or Ishvara. So I can say Indian philosophy is positively secular. We talk about spirituality and logic more than anything in these lectures. So in Indian philosophy, we will explore the concept of God and meaning of life in a logical way, and that is going to be our memorable journey. Now, let's have a background of Indian philosophy, how all this has started. It is said that wonder is the origin of the philosophy, and same is applicable to Indian philosophy. Our ancient seers wondered at the grandeur and mechanism of this universe, nature and its laws, and tried to explain this phenomena of world logically. Then by logical deduction, they were convinced that there must be someone who created all this. There must be a brilliant brain behind this. There must be a wonderful architect who is second to none, who is unmatchable behind this complex, sophisticated, powerful, magnificent design of this universe. Now, having convinced about the presence of supreme and ultimate, that is God, they want to know why God made all this. They thought God is not silly to create all this. There must be a reason for the creation of this world and humans. So there is a task to all humans and maybe even to other living beings. They want to know the reason why God created all this. They want to know the secret behind all this creation. Now many speculations have started about God and the reason behind this creation. The goal before them is not just to find the reason, but complete the task given by God. It must be the highest good, that is, summum bonum of life. Summum bonum means the highest good, the thing that if you get, you won't look for anything else. The thing other than that, everything else is meaningless. The only thing that is sufficient and need to be possessed by every human, the invaluable treasure and everything. That is summum bonum of life, and the goal is to get that. Now, how to get that treasure? Many ideologies came up to the surface. Also, there was a general scheme about the origin of universe in Vedas, but there were only statements without any logical explanation. But people were believing what is said in Vedas and trying to practice them. Meanwhile, if you have already studied ancient India, you know that many superstitions, restrictions, fake interpretations of Vedas entered the Hindu religion. Advantage was being taken over on the name of revelations of God, or I can say dictums of God. Society was divided into levels and some groups were denied progress in society. Meanwhile, on the name of religion, many people started looting corners. Many people were tired of this. They are looking for something else which can better their position in society. They want to get out of all this. Because of the fake interpretations of holy books by learned men, many people slowly started thinking that these are not holy books, but are only speculations. Other religions are also coming up, like Buddhism. People were offered better place in society in Buddhism. No fake interpretations. The most powerful Buddha, he himself is there. His charisma is divine. His lectures are magical. His methods are practical. People were being spellbound by his behavior, calmness, personality. Haters were being shut up with his cool attitude and powerful logic and whatnot. Common people started converting into Buddhism and Jainism. Now the ancient rishis felt bad that the brilliant Vedas are being ignored. They are unable to stop these mass conversions. Now they decided that let us make common people understand that these are not just speculations and there is a logic behind each and everything in Vedas or practices of Sanatana Dharma. And supplying this logic is the task given to the ancient seers. And that, I don't say the beginning, but the great period in which Indian philosophy flourished. And that's the start of golden age for Indian philosophy, and it is continuous and reach the inflection point, the summit, with the entry of Vedic schools in Indian philosophy. And with that, the departure of Buddhism from India. So, if you see, the age of Buddha is the great turning point in the history of philosophic spirit in India. The powerful attack of Buddhists, atheists, has exploded the dogmatism of ancient Sanatana Dharma. As Buddhist thinkers have come up with powerful logic as a weapon, ancient traditional thinkers slowly built a bastion of ancient philosophy and shielded it from destruction forever with much more powerful logic. Whenever the skepticism and questions again if something is genuine, and if the efforts for answering that questions are genuine, the progress of that theory only becomes rich. And the criticism has helped to reorganize the ancient belief system and helped to lay the foundation of philosophy much deeper. The conservative schools are now compelled to codify and systemize their viewpoints and were compelled to set forth the logical differences. The critical side of philosophy has become as important as speculative one. Because of the critics, no more you can simply make a statement as a revelation of God if you can't support that statement with logic. Now, all such attempts to gather the ideas about the world and supply them with logic were regarded as darshanas. Darshanas literally means vision. This vision helps us to see some aspect of the truth. Now, let us briefly see some important darshanas of Indian philosophy. There are 6 conservative schools in Indian philosophy, and for these schools, Vedas and Upanishads are the foundations, and they are here followed with their most important exponent or person of that school. These are called as Shat Darshanas, which literally means 6 visions. First one is Nyaya, and the most important person of this school is Gautama, and Vaisheshika, and the most important person is Kannada, Samkhya, and the person is Kapila, Yoga by Patanjali, Purva Mimamsa by Jaimini, and Vedanta or Uttar Mimamsa by Badrayana. And these 6 schools are called as Brahmanical or Orthodox system since they accept the authority of Vedas. And the system of thought that accepts the authority of Vedas are called Astika, and the system of thought which doesn't accept the authority of Vedas are called as Nastika. The Nastika schools of Indian philosophy are here. First one is Charvaka. These are materialists. We will see about them in the next lecture. And the next is Buddhism. And next another is Jainism. These two comes under unorthodox schools of Indian philosophy. The next point I want to highlight is about the acceptance of Vedas. The acceptance of authority of Veda doesn't mean either full agreement with all the doctrines of the Veda or admission of any belief in the existence of God. It means only a serious attempt to solve the ultimate mystery of existence. Because even it is not agreed that Veda is infallible, or it is not possible for a Veda to be wrong. It is not admitted by all the schools. Purva Mimamsa and Sankhya doesn't believe that God is the creator of the world. But still they are considered as Astika school or Orthodox school of Indian philosophy, because they believe in the authority of Vedas. We can't say that philosophical system is compromised by acceptance of Vedas. As once you say God said this, you only have to cook up the logic to support this. But because the complex Vedic language, it made it possible to have multiple interpretations of what God revealed in the first place. Now, the author of the philosophical schools, depending upon their predilections, made different interpretations. Also, the Vedas are very vast, so others can freely choose out of their confusion any portion of Vedas, and then they build their original thought with the help of that. And every system of Indian school or darshana is a mixture of logic, psychology, metaphysics, and religion. Further, there are common points between the 6 orthodox systems, and we shall explore this at the right time during our lectures. This is the brief sketch of Indian schools of philosophy. Firstly, we have heterodox school or Nastika schools and orthodox schools or Astika schools that accept the Vedic authority. In the heterodox schools or the schools that doesn't accept the Vedic authority are Charvaka, Buddhism and Jainism. And the orthodox schools, that is which accepts the authority of Veda, are further divided into 2 types. One is school based on Vedic texts and schools based on independent grounds, that means they have different grounds for their philosophy. First of the schools based on independent grounds, first is Samkhya, then Patanjali Yoga philosophy, which is very famous, then Nyaya and Vaisheshika. We can say Nyaya and Vaisheshika are almost similar, and we can consider them as one in our discussions. Next is the schools based on Vedic texts. There are 2 schools. One is Purva Mimamsa and another is Uttar Mimamsa. Purva Mimamsa mostly concentrate upon the ritualistic aspects of Vedas, means the rituals that are prescribed in Vedas. It tries to explain the logic behind those rituals. Another is speculative aspect of Vedas, that is Uttar Mimamsa or Vedanta. This is the highest school of Indian philosophy I can say. The last thing for this lecture that you have to note is that although there are many different schools and their views differ sometimes very widely, each school take care to learn the views of all others and did not come to conclusion before considering very thoroughly what others had to say and how their points of view could be met. This spirit led to the formation of method of philosophical discussion. That is, even though there are many schools, each school, they are learning from other school, they listen to their arguments, then they come up with their own argument. And in the Indian philosophy, if any person who make a statement or a philosopher had to state first the views of the opponent, what opponent is saying, and this is called as prior view or Purvapaksha. First he will say the Purvapaksha, then he will make argument to make the opponent's case nullify, and then he will come with his statement, and then he prove it with his own logic, which is called as subsequent view or the conclusion, Siddhanta. In Indian philosophy, we see that first there is a discussion on argument by opposite school, then there is a criticism on that school, then the philosopher comes with a new statement of his own and he will try to prove this statement, and there is another philosopher who will criticize this and who make an argument against this, and then he comes with this new statement and new proof. And in Indian philosophy, all answers are questioned. Further, following are the recommended books for this series on Indian philosophy. First one is Introduction to Indian Philosophy by Datta and Chatterjee. This is a very short and crisp book. It is better that after listening to the lecture, you complete your first reading from here, and the English language used in this book is also very simple. Next one is Indian Philosophy Volume 1 and 2 by Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. You heard this author name somewhere else, right? Yes, you are correct. He has done a lot of work on philosophy and he is the one who made it possible for us to read Indian philosophy subject freely at our homes. Otherwise, this knowledge was shared mostly in Hindi mutts only, like Sringeri Mutt, Ramakrishna Mission, etc. The other books are here. You can have them as a reference, but you need to have one channeled book of the above and follow the lectures closely. And the transcript of this video will be available on the Telegram channel and the link is given in the description box. If you like this video, please like, share and subscribe and press the bell icon to get more updates. Thank you.